a real pleasure to be here. I'm a researcher at Reykjavik University, and I've been working on AI for almost 3 decades now. And I'm here to tell you about some of the very interesting things that my team and I have come up with in the past decade or so. So to start off, and I have quite a lot of slides. I'm going to go quickly, and you know, if you want to ask me questions about any of those, we can do it at the end. So just to clarify the goal, what is the goal that I've been working towards with my team? So what I want to do is create a machine that can achieve autonomy, that can have multiple simultaneous goals, that can handle resource limitations, knowledge extraction, and handling knowledge limitations autonomously. And we want to work towards generality. So we want some sort of domain independence. We want it to learn, be able to learn a bunch of a multitude of tasks, have a unified representation of multiple data types, and so on. I'll come back to these. And the moniker we've chosen that I like is to stick general in between artificial and intelligence, because we want to emphasize the fact that this is our primary goal. So just to clarify a little bit more, what is the G in AGI here? An AGI system should be able to learn to be able to perform a host of unanticipated tasks of numerous kinds, so to handle novelty, adapt to vastly new circumstances, actively acquire knowledge as needed, and here we're basically talking about novelty, context, cumulative learning. So the more it learns, the better it gets at not just doing the things it's already learned, the better it gets at doing other things that are similar. Real time, that it's working all the time to acquire such knowledge. Autonomy, and belabor the point, but really, we want it to do all of the aforementioned at any time, at all times, after it leaves the lab, under resource constraints. So these resource constraints could be temporal, computational knowledge, etc. So that is one way to formulate the G and AGI here. So that brings up the question, if we want to build a system like that, and it's already quite different, I hope you agree with me, from the things that we're using now, state-of-the-art AI, deep learning, etc. Well, if we look again at this list, the autonomy that we are really after is actually not a good match to the current methodology that we have. Because the system we want to build is less like this and more like this. So again, what tools, methods, approaches should we pick? The obvious way to create a forest, of course, is to grow it from seeds. So we look at current methods, which are basically hand tools. All programming languages that are in use today, popular use, have been built for intelligences to use. So if we want a machine that can code with those with the programming languages, it already needs to be intelligent. So that's a conundrum. And you know, you throw in some more powerful machinery, this doesn't seem right. You know, you wouldn't build a hacksaw to grow a forest. So really, our conclusion is sort of like this: current methods, given these goals, it's like Larson's joke here, where the cat says, "We still got a couple of years to go before we're ready for the moon." It's a reference to the cowboys of the moon. Instead, what we really need to look for are methods of seat design, methods for self-instruction, and principles for self-growth. So this is what we started with. We said, okay, what do we need in here? Can we take anything from the environment or the current development environment to fill this in? And actually, we ended up with the answer no. So at the bottom, we have the operating system of current computers. And at the top, we have the scientific principles. And we actually filled this in with something new all the way. Guided by a new constructivist AI methodology, we invented a new programming language specifically geared for this kind of a system. We also invented a new logic that unifies abduction, induction, and deduction to produce what's called amplitude reasoning. We come up with principles for self-reflective coding, new programming paradigm. And given this, we implement control architecture called ERA. I'll show you a video if I don't run out of time about that shows how this system runs. So the key principles of this system, and I'll come back to this a couple of times, are autoanalysis, heterogeneity, and self-reflection. Self-reflection has to do with the system being able to look at its own operation. Heterogeneity means that the system can generate sub-goals autonomously. And autocatalysis means that the system is really event-driven throughout, and any event anywhere could trigger another event somewhere else. And so all processing is really done as a pressure. So I think I'll go a bit more quickly through these. These are the same points. And what you have essentially is we don't actually have these parts here, memory, focus, learning, and planning. These are not really modules in the system. These are actually a part of memory. These are processes that whose interaction produces knowledge acquisition and planning and so on. And there are some other unique features, design features of the system that we really kind of don't have time to go through, because I want to show you the video. To summarize, the design of this architecture is very holistic. It's sort of like a Mozart symphony. Forgive the analogy there, but if you take one note, and the whole thing falls apart. It's really not the kind of, it's more biological-like than sort of the traditional software system. So we built the system, and we wanted to see what it could do and how well it could do the things that we were aiming for. So we come up with a task that's really hard to have any machine learning system learn, which is how to do an interview. And we're really talking about a multimodal, real-time, natural language discussion here, where there's an interviewer and an interviewee. So what you will see is a system that does goal-level imitation learning. It observes two people talking. One is interviewing the other. The interaction between these two is essentially like TV-style interview. These are not trained after. We have about 100 word vocabulary. And looking, pointing, all of these are not scripted at all. These are just the things that people do in this session. And the experimental setup is sort of like this. You've got, it's sort of like a teleconference, except you don't see the other's video image, you see the other student's avatar. And otherwise, everything is exactly the same. You hear their speech, you see them move, etc. So we track people with special techniques. And the S1 era agent, which we call S1, observes the data flow in real time. These are some example utterances that we observed in these interactions. So these are not simple sentences. They're not ultra complex. It's not like a German philosopher wrote them. I mean, these are generated dynamically as people are talking. But you know, more energy is needed to recycle a plastic bottle than a can of aluminum, etc. So you hear some more. And what we have, essentially in the video, is the result after 20 hours of observation, roughly 200 interviews. And then the system jumps into the body of one of the avatars and runs the interaction in the same way. So switch now to see the video.
What is this object?
This cardboard box is made from wood fibers. Wood comes from the forest. Cardboard boxes are biodegradable. Cardboard takes 2 months to disintegrate in the sun.
What is this?
This is a glass bottle. Glass is made by melting together several minerals. Silica sand is the main mineral in glass. Most glass can be recycled endlessly as long as it is sorted properly. Glass bottles can be washed and refilled. A glass bottle takes 1 million years to disintegrate completely in the sun.
Which releases more greenhouse gases when produced, a glass bottle or an aluminum can?
Making a new glass bottle releases more greenhouse gases than making a new aluminum can.
What can you tell us about this subject?
This can is made of aluminum. A recycled aluminum can pollutes only 5% of what a new one pollutes.
Tell us about this object.
This is a glass bottle. Glass can be recycled by grating into filler. Most glass can be recycled endlessly as long as it has been sorted properly.
Which releases more greenhouse gases when produced, a glass bottle or a plastic bottle?
Making a glass bottle releases more greenhouse gases than a plastic bottle.
What is this thing?
This is a cardboard box made from natural wood fibers. Wood comes from the forest or from recycled fiber. Cardboard boxes are biodegradable. Cardboard box takes 2 months to disintegrate in the sun.
What else can you tell us about it?
Fiber cannot be recycled endlessly like metal. What is this object?
This cardboard box is made from natural wood fibers. Wood comes from the forest or from recycled fiber. Fiber cannot be recycled endlessly like metal. Cardboard boxes are biodegradable. Cardboard box takes 2 months to disintegrate in the sun.
What is this?
This newspaper is made from natural wood fibers. Recycled paper can be used to make new paper. Newspaper takes 6 weeks to disintegrate in the sun. Newspaper is biodegradable. Recycling paper saves 40% energy.
What else?
compared to recycling, making new paper results in 75% more air pollution.
Tell me about this object.
This is an aluminum can. The main ingredient in aluminum is bauxite.
What else?
All metals are recyclable. Aluminum can be recycled virtually endlessly. The recycled aluminum can cost 95% less than a new one.
Tell us about this object.
This is a glass bottle. Most glass can be recycled endlessly assuming it has been sorted by color. Glass bottles can be washed and refilled.
Which releases more greenhouse gases when produced, a glass bottle or a plastic bottle?
Making a glass bottle releases more greenhouse gases than a plastic bottle.
Spurious errors in it. But basically, formulating sentences, the only unit that is a given, basically, that the system sees as a token, are the words. Everything else, how to sequence these words to make grammatically correct utterances, and how to generate a correct answer to a question, is completely learned from scratch. So how does it do this? What does the seed look like? And I'm going to show you this in a couple of slides. We actually do, those of you who think about graphics a lot, you probably noticed that the movements were a bit sort of smooth, maybe smoother than normal human movements. And that's because we did actually filter the movements. So they're basically granularized a little bit coarser than your normal kind of video signal would be. But basically, we give the system, in the system, there are some buttons which are essentially given up front, and this is told, we tell the system this in C design. There is a function called, well, it could be called anything, but we call it grab so that you remember what it is. There's no meaning to this, it's just a button with a label on it. And the system will observe when humans actually move close to an object, the hand grabs the object automatically. And when they lift it up and put it back down, it releases. So this was a simplification in a sense, but basically it doesn't change the mechanisms at work here. Pointing at and looking at and so on, and then a small knowledge network where we give some tags on the graphical objects in the world. Otherwise, the system is just observing XYZ coordinates and data flowing, changes in XYZ coordinates or various things. And the other thing that we gave the system, and this is really the key here, is we tell the system what to do by giving it the top level goals of an interviewer and an interviewee. And yes, it's a bit simplified, you know, from the human situation, because of course interviewers, human interviewers may have very deep levels of goals. But here we simplify this to basically still very high level. The top level goal of the interviewer is to get the interviewee to talk. And the top level goals of the interviewee, there are basically, well, depending on how you count, two or three. So, is to talk, conditional on, being prompted, only talk about properties that you're being asked about, and for as long as there are properties available, but have not already been mentioned. And these two slides that I just went through here take up about 5 pages of code, regular code. And that's a complete account of what the system knows in front. Everything else is just observing the data flowing back and forth, trying to figure out how to achieve those top level goals. And during that learning, it creates hypotheses for how to achieve it, and then it uses observation to basically falsify or strengthen those hypotheses. So now we can come back to the these things, and I just want to emphasize this again. So the desired operation of the system is actually fairly holistic. It has a number of general purpose, well, a small number of general purpose underlying processes that when they interact and catalyze each other, it generates planning, attention control, or resource control, and action, and sensing. And we have no particular components called learning, or there's no special knowledge base. The knowledge base is the runtime system. And just to give you a hint, the atomic representation of the system is called a model. It's a very small, kind of like a line of C++ or something. It's a fairly small statement. And in the beginning, we had 26 of these models. That was what encoded the seed, as I mentioned before. And when the system ran this smoothly, as you saw in the video, it has generated 1,400 other models that it used. And, well, probably shouldn't go into too much detail here on the models, because we want to get a couple of minutes for questions. I mentioned this already. So, conclusions. What I have shown you here is a new kind of AI. It's based on very different principles from what you've probably seen before. If not, let me know, and I'd love to check that out. Demonstrating a high level of autonomy and low level learning, where the learning, the attention control, and the fine parameters of digital time are actually transparently and transversally represented in the system. And something I didn't actually get too much into here is the graceful handling of incomplete knowledge. We also have created this new AI methodology, constructivist AI methodology. And ERA really stands for as a blueprint of self-expanding architecture. If you want to read more about this, there's a long tech report. Other things you can probably find by Googling. So I want to thank my human ops team. This is an M7 project that involved the following labs. It's the second time that you see it comes up on the screen today. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Unfortunately, we have time only for one quick question, but Christy will be a member of the panel discussion, so you can ask questions for him using Slido. So one question. Over there.
Here we go. I took precedence of that. I have a question. You said that the agent doesn't make any mistakes. During training, how does it attest the truthfulness of the information?
Who's asking?
You said that the agent doesn't make any mistakes. So during training, how does it know if the information is correct? How does it attest the truthfulness of the information?
Yes, good question. It doesn't make any mistakes. It may be a bit of an exaggeration. It doesn't make any mistakes in light of what it has actually observed. And the behavior is very, very close to human behavior, but there were some peculiarities that have to do with the I/O devices that we use, for instance, the speech synthesizer and so on. I don't know if you noticed that sometimes the speech is weird, and sometimes words kind of butt up against each other. But there was no incident, for instance, of a word appearing sooner than it should be, grammatically speaking. So, just to clarify that. But how does it know that that things are working? Because the system operates on the general principle that all of its knowledge is generated from predictions. So it predicts how the agents, the humans, in fact, achieve the goal of the dialogue. And when it observes something that breaks its predictions, it creates new predictions, it creates new models. And the 20 hours comes from basically the time it needed to get pretty much all of them right. So you can stop the system at any time, and it'll be sort of there. I don't know if it's quite linear. I mean, it's probably a bit bumpy, but that's how it does it. So it continues to learn. You don't have to turn off the learning because it already has the top-level goals, and you know the system is not going to do anything that that invalidates those goals, and the more it knows, the more true that prediction.